we're actually, that's like right now.
Did you get that okay?
Yeah.
And that we can.
I did not get that, I'm sorry. Was it worth it?
I'm not making the motion.
Alright.
Alright. And that we approve the minutes from last month's meeting.
So moved.
And a second?
Who's that?
Basso?
Basso, yeah. Also.
Mary. And roll call vote on that?
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Basso Alfaris?
Yes.
Roger Black?
Yes.
Marianne Alexandra?
Yes.
Henry Hill?
Yes. And then we can go to all business with Steve.
Mr. Chairman, first thing we have is a request for a rehearing. The rehearing request is by Tammy Doss, located at 16 Camp Lane. It's appeal number 1287, asking to place, she will be asking to place a modular home on a parcel within an A2 airport district.
And this, we should be able to rehear that. So can we have a motion on that?
Make a motion?
Reopen.
Reopen.
Also.
Show of hands on that one. And roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Basso Alfaris?
Yes.
Roger Black?
Yes.
Marianne Alexandra?
Yes.
Henry Hill?
Yes.
Okay, now, Mr. Chairman, the first appeal, Mr. Gino?
Yes, sir.
You're first.
Yeah, see right here in the front.
Right in the front, front and center.
Okay.
This appeal number 1427, Harold and John Gino, Gino's Insurance, they're asking for an area variance. Request to be allowed to increase the size of the sign for the commercial business to 6 square feet, which is not allowed in an R2 district, residential districts. And it does not conform to the conditions of their variance granted on April 12th of 2000. Alan can go over the details of where this is located and some of the renderings that were submitted to us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Right now we are sitting in the town hall, which sits right here. This is Banker Road, Route 3 here, Tom Little here. Insurance company sits right here. In this parcel right here, this is an R2 district. This is the insurance company right here. This is a single family residential home, also on the property. So here's what it looks like today. It's a small office, one person, I think one person in the secretary. So they've got this little informational sign here. It's their sign. 2 square feet is what was allowed back in 2000 when they got the variance. They're looking to replace this sign with a 6 square foot sign going in this area here. So this is a drawing proposed. It's that door entranceway. They're looking to put the sign right there between the window and the door. Hey, Mr. Dean, if you have anything to add, you can add this time.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Basically, I'd like to change it so that it's, it kind of looks like what's being proposed in the town. You know, these, you got like red view, even the town sign. You know, I just want to update the sign rather than just a vinyl sign, basically. And try to make it a little bit more classier. You know, look nicer.
Signs that were approved.
Well, yes. Actually, right here.
But that would depend on the zoning if you're actually in R2.
I didn't ask for that when I went to the county. There used to be the building used to be a restaurant, similar to what Devani's was back in the 70s. My father and my mother had it open, and there was a metal pole. I don't know if you can see it here. You can see a piece of the pole and then here. Used to have a Western Drive on here. And that was the other sign, used to be a star there. You know, similar to what Ronnie was about to take that. I'm not looking to do that, I'm just trying to update it on the building. The county, when I talked to the county last week, they said for them, it was fine putting something on the building. I wasn't trying to put something up by the wall. Originally I was, but I changed my mind basically. And I was trying to update it and make it look a little bit more classier than just a vinyl sign.
So basically you're looking just, it isn't because it's an identification thing, you're just looking to...
Well, it's kind of a book. Yeah.
Those are variants put into place, so the original variance to allow a commercial operation to be done in the residential district?
It was a commercial building at one point, sorry, and then it changed to residential.
Right, but I'm saying it was, obviously, I wasn't here in 2000, you guys gave a variance then because it was a residential district to allow this business, so was there a variance already? Was there anything in place about the signage for that original variance?
Right, and it said 2 square feet as well.
Right, because whenever you do a home business, you're only allowed 2 square feet in a residential district.
6 square feet, yeah. Today, a home occupation is allowed 6 square foot sign.
Okay, when the.
Home occupation.
Home occupation.
Right.
That's less 6 square feet?
Yeah.
It's not home occupation.
That changed in 2012.
Okay.
That was the other reason why I was looking at taking this, I was hoping to see if we could pass that. Because the variance had changed, or the guidelines had changed in 2012.
Open up public hearing portion of the meeting, does anybody here like to speak to this matter? I see anybody raise their hand or come forward, I will close the public hearing portion of the meeting.
Mr. Chairman, I did get a correspondence from the neighbor.
Okay.
So, could not make it tonight, and didn't feel like he could control and stuff, they have a neighborhood dispute, we'll just say that. So this was from Richard Mitchell at 990 Route 3, which is one house up. Mr. Mitchell submitted a issues. So he's asking, business sign is in a residential district, he's asking whether it would be on the building or it would be posted in the yard, because it wasn't indicated on there. That was his first question. And there's none in the yard, how long, they lasted this long without one being there, any bigger, why do they need one now? It's been in existence, what makes this any different than there, the business has been there. Banker Road and Route 3 is already bad and poor intersection, this will add more people, traffic coming to the intersection, going to, sorry, what, Mr. Gino's, what's your number?
984.
Okay, 984, and will the sign make this better or worse by having this more signage that people are gonna be looking to the right or the left, depending on which way they're going, and it's gonna be more of a distraction and an already dangerous intersection? Mr. Richard Mitchell.
Thank you.
The present sign has lighting above it. If you were to put a sign between the window and the door, would that be lit? Would you have a light from either the ground or?
And the light, when it comes on, it's a motion when time changes.
Okay, that's just for access.
For people to walk in so they can see.
Okay, so it's not just to light up the sign, okay?
No, not in the light of the sign.
You have to do a secret in this one?
It's an area variance because he's already allowed a sign, 2 square feet.
That's why it says in my notes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Only any use variance.
It appears to me that the reason why it was 2 square feet, 2,000, because I had a home occupation years ago, so I moved it, but it was probably to be in accordance with residential home occupation sign size. Would that be the current theory there?
Yeah.
From what I understand, that's changed in 2012.
Yeah, the old used to say only 2 square feet, it actually had to be.
No, it didn't have to be in the building. I had it on the road.
Yeah, there, I think it said it couldn't be on the building, so it had to be off the road.
Oh, separate, freestanding.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, this one says now that you can allow 6 square feet, you have to either or.
Right. Yep.
Would you want to reduce it down and put it over your entrance where it's not going to be heading from one direction?
Yeah, if I could do a four or whatever would fit in the, you see with the second.
Yeah, it looks like a 4 square foot.
It would probably fit a 4 square foot and make it similar to this, so that it's a little bit more professional.
I personally think that in the spirit of why
still have to follow 5 foot off your front property line, 20 feet off your side property line for freestanding.
Alright, yeah, that sounds good.
I'll second that. Roger, but second, and show hand on that. And roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Tessa LaFarge?
Yes.
Mark Black?
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexandro?
Yes.
Henry Hill?
Yes. Which means you can go left and still put over your entrance there, so you get better vantage point if you want to do that.
Alright, very good, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, good luck.
Anywhere. Have a good day.
Next appeal, Mr. Obias, is UMS property at 147 Pleasant Ridge. This is, Mr. Chairman, this is gonna be three separate variances, three or four, three separate variances. We're doing this for logistics of making sure, because the parcels, there's two separate parcels that UMS is asking for. Deficient of a side or rear, and then the last one will be for open space. Deficient up there, so just for the public, we're gonna have three separate ones. We're gonna introduce it as one, and then there's three separate variances that are being requested. We'll go over the three, give you an overview, then we'll let Mr. Obias take over from there. This is 147 Pleasant Ridge Road. The first appeal that they're asking for is an area variance request to be allowed to construct a building addition connection building on a separate parcel that would be deficient in the required sum of the side yards for 50 feet and only 22.3 being provided. The next one is an area variance to construct a 2,500 square foot addition that would increase the overall coverage into 53.6% of the property, where only 40% coverage is allowed. The other one is an area variance request to allow to construct a building addition connection to a building on a separate parcel that would be deficient of the 20-foot rear yard setback with 0 being provided. To give the audience, they're trying to do a sky bridge connecting the production building into a storage distribution building, and it's actually cut up into three parcels over there now. Three separate parcels, so even though it's owned by the same company, they have different LLCs that they're doing in there for tax purposes. I'm guessing for tax purposes, each different division owns different parts of this overall campus. So to break it down a little more, this is Schluter. You have production, you have the original buildings, then you have a couple different plants on the side that have been built. So a complex facility, and Alan can try to get you guys navigate you through the details of this one.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, this is Pleasant Ridge Road coming around here, I-87 here. This is what we call the Schluter complex right here. There's actually, this is one parcel, this is one parcel, and then this is one parcel. So you can maybe see a little better the red line here in the purple. You see one, two, three parcels. We're dealing with these two parcels right here. So a little closer, so it's this building here as well as this building. They're going to be adding a bridge that comes out from this building and over to this building. There's going to be a building addition underneath the bridge at this point, and there's going to be a recycle center addition at this point over here. Here's kind of what it looks like. So just past this bump out here is a loading dock area. It's going to come out, and it's going to come back over towards this loading dock area. And then that recycle center is going to be right up here, cardboard compactor sitting up here. These are plans submitted by the engineer. You can see here, this is that bridge area coming in right here. Recycle center is right here, and the maintenance addition is right here. Same thing, just a little bit blown up. So now you can see a little closer. And this is the property line coming through here. So you can see we got 0 lot lines right here. This is addition, and that's the addition. Mr. Obias, all yours.
Aaron Obias representing Robert Sutherland here before you with the UMS properties variances. See, now that you've done explaining it, basically, let's go back to like the part you came to map. Thank you. All of the buildings located on the north side of the property are basically warehousing, shipping, receiving, distribution. The two, one building was built over
times that that's been done, I guess because this is owned by the same entity, so to speak, that was the requirement that should the parcel be sold to a disinterested party, that it would be taken down?
Well, what we've done, I believe that was the TAD situation, that was a requirement. When you looked at Champlain Center in the south, north, and also Hippocrates, it's a reciprocal easement agreement that bound them together. So even if there was a change in the entity name, that person is buying into the approvals and bound by that reciprocal easement, so they can't deviate from what you're approving without obviously coming back to you. So that reciprocal easement agreement will bound it all together, so that you could have potential of a corporate name change. So this becomes, you know, production and storage, you know, they change that, you know, names, that we wouldn't have to say to break down, because they are still bound by that easement agreement that blocks the two together, so that they share a green space, they share, you know, all those numbers. So we'd like to not have that, obviously, because if there was a sale of one arm of the division to the other arm of the division, we obviously wouldn't want to tear the bridge down.
Well, I guess not to the same arm of the same division. I'm talking to an arm's length transaction with a third party that is not Schuler's.
Yeah, but they still have to go with the reciprocal easement agreement.
Right.
Right. I mean, if you look at the South Mall, Lowe's owns their footprint separate from Pyramid, Pyramid LLC or whatever it's called. So you have your Champlain LLC, so you have different entities, but again, they're bound together by that common agreement. Certainly your Target, separate from the North.
I guess going back to the TAD, we were discussing, you said that that did work when it was sold, it did have to be torn down across those two property lines.
Something that we never thought would be sold differently.
Right.
You know, and it did split ways, and it was only 20 feet apart.
Correct.
So that did happen, and never know, this would be the next GP. We always say this is the Jeep George Pacific, but without the PCBs and the lake. So, Schluter, Detroit's no longer the new nicest thing, so that's a lot of square footage for something to rent.
Yeah.
Trying to predict that, we can predict that. Hopefully they last forever and ever, and they never leave the town and keep on employing everybody. But that being said, if they ever were to dissolve, but I can see Aaron's argument or discussion point is that right now it's, correct me if I'm going to say these right or wrong, UMR, UMS, and
UMS properties, UMS properties. UMR is a tenant. So in other words, each of their divisions, you know, so UMR is a tenant inside a UMS portion. Then over here, you actually have SSF, which is a separate entity who's completely different ownership, but they do share some services. So you're a totally separate legal entity, but again, all the parcels are bound by that reciprocal easement agreement, so they still have the rights to share and drive over each other's property to share, you know, the drainage and the sewer and the water and everything else. So they are all bound together by that agreement.
But how does a reciprocal agreement cause a problem if the this walkway or this connector would be torn down if it was sold to a third party?
Well, I guess why, if we've 10 years from now, 20 years from now, if we sold one of the buildings and it became this name is Schluter, we rented the warehouse to somebody else and we called it a different name.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, why would we want to tear that down? We want to maintain that so that maybe the tenant rents it from both sides. Yeah, so we would.
But that'd still be the same entity on the same, not the same entity.
Not necessarily. You could change
the ownership. I'm saying if one of these parcels was sold out to a third party, not the fact that somebody is going to go in and occupy.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm saying right. If you sold one of those.
Right. To a third party.
Right. To a third party. But say that third party also wants to rent space over here.
Yeah.
So UMS still owns this, but Jack and Jill own this. Why would I want to take down the bridge if they still use that? Yeah. We would like to keep it. We would not want to have that restriction placed on the variance. We prefer not to have a restriction placed on the variance. Obviously, as I said, this has been done. You know, the TAD was the one case which that was put in the condition. The others, and I can't say, but I know the other three that I represented for you all
change in neighborhood character or to nearby properties, basically it's a large campus, industrial, commercial type buildings. Whether requested substantial on the whole.
When you look at the entire campus as a whole.
It is not. And whether the request will have adverse physical or environmental effects. And whether the alleged difficulty is self-created, actually is hopefully going to diminish.
If they approve on the environmental effects, and the town planning board has done seeker, and we're in favor of that.
And. Being self-created, if it has to obligate us from creating a variance, so. Can we have a motion on that?
I'll make a motion, grant the variance.
No, second.
Let's do a motion, let's name the variance.
1741.
Okay, and show of hands then. And a roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Tessa LaFarge?
Yes.
Curtis Black?
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander?
Yes.
Henry Hill?
Yes. Well, that's how we're voting it out, I know.
Now, the one you just did was, I think, the bridge.
They're gonna be interconnected with two separate parcel ID numbers. So in order for tracking from here on out, the variance goes with the land. So we're the sky bridge, whatever you want.
So we talked about together, it was basically three separate variances.
I guess I wanna go back to, is there any stipulation we put in there about this reciprocal agreement that should that ever be severed, that it would be a good outcome of this?
Do we have a copy of any of that for planning department?
It was a requirement of planning board. Copies were filed with planning staff, we're more than happy, it is on file with clerk's office, so it is found in any searches that, you know, that's found with the land.
Just because 20 years from now, we're not gonna.
Yeah, the one point, I guess, is that Aaron was making, but even stormwater management, like because of that lot, everything, correct me if I'm wrong, everything goes to the south.
Yep.
So even for stormwater management, that's part of the agreement, so you can never really parcel off without that reciprocal easement. Your water, your stormwater, the lighting, everything else is tied together, and that is different from Batat, because Batat had two separate, they had all their own parking, they had their own.
Right, but I'm just saying that we don't know what's gonna happen.
Yes.
So I think that we should at least add that stipulation on that variance request.
Right, is that what you agree on?
I would say with all three of them.
Right.
Can we put the stipulation along with the variance with all three separate out?
Should something sever that reciprocal?
Absolutely.
So, did you get all that?
Do you need me to?
Yes.
Can I do second?
All right, so field number 1944 for the Middleton Bridge. And same thing with the buy-in that I just went over on the first criteria. So if we have a motion on that, for field number 1944.
I'll make a motion to accept.
And.
With the language.
Reciprocal. And a second?
I'll second.
And a show of hands. And a roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Tessa LaFarge?
Yes.
Curtis Black?
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander?
Yes.
Henry Hill?
Yes. And field number 2119 for the side yard, or rear yard setback. Which would be basically not fine for the bridge.
Same situation.
And you have a motion on that one?
I'll make a motion to grant the variance with the reciprocal language. Field number 2119.
Second?
I'll second.
Okay, and a show of hands. And a roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Tessa LaFarge?
Yes.
Curtis Black?
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander?
Yes.
Henry Hill?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next appeal is 2103, Mr. Macon. Mr. Macon is 37 LaTour Avenue. He's back in front of us to request to be allowed to convert a property into a multifamily dwelling in an SC service center district, which is now a permitted use. Mr. Macon was in front of us a few months ago and needed more info. He needed, you guys had a lot of questions for him. The
tidied up, if you will. So Alan can go over the details of where Mr. Macon's 37 Latour Avenue is.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, this is Latour Avenue here. This is Route 9 North, going out of town. Channel 5, TV station's over here, just to help you locate where it's at. So there's this large parcel right here, the house that's up here in the front. There's a detached garage filling the back of it. So this is the parcel right here. This is the house here, detached garage building. Here's what it looks like today. That's all I got.
The secret form, did you remove that at all, Alan?
The good one?
No.
No.
There's still some items on there.
Yeah, there has been no new information submitted to us, so.
This is the same?
It's all still the same stuff from a couple of months ago.
All right, so one of the things that we had said previously, and I know you submitted a handwritten answering the questions. Try to return that property into a apartment for you to determine, I guess it is. And do you have any evidence of what the other items in the service center can be used in that property area?
The house was sealed for, I think, 10 or 15 years.
Yeah.
Nobody was lying about this in there. It's a dead end road. It's not good for any other business. It was before for family homes, for the owners. I think it's better to be a bit flat to go, not to be lost before.
Usually we'd have somebody come in and say that there's, what, 15 or 20 different items that in the service center, there's different uses that are allowed. Even doctor's offices, professional offices, automobile repair, things in there.
Yeah, there's only one, you can always do it.
I realize that, but even, I think, is there one where there's a commercial office on the lower floor that you can actually put in the lines above?
That's correct.
Did you look into that at all?
Yes, I do for office, the residential area, just across the way, the trailer park.
I realize what you're saying, but the thing of it is, it's in the service center, so you're looking for a use variance for the property. And that's why we would, and I think we stated this before, is that you needed to have financial evidence. If you looked at all the different possibilities and say why you can't get to one of these other uses that is already approved.
Yes, if we change the use, it's gonna be too much investment to, because it's already converted in the four units, so that would be much easier.
I just want to say, as a real estate broker, I've been in this house, I looked at this house, and I have to agree with Mr. Macon that if any other business that is listed on the service center wanted to go in there, it had gone in there a long time ago, because that place has been on the market a long time. And when I looked at it, it was clearly and had been used as a residential use. And personally, from my professional opinion, as well as personally, I think the best use for this at this point, and it's hard to make it into something else. And if somebody wanted to go to a dead end street to try to drum up business, they'd probably seek other market avenues to do it. But then its best use really is the residential use of some sort. And I also think, so I would side with Mr. Macon on that, because the property doesn't really lend itself to be something else. And if any of those businesses wanted to go in there, they'd purchase this thing a long time ago, because it needed a lot of work. So that's just my opinion.
Well, let's open up public hearing portion of the meeting. Anybody here like to speak to this matter?
Yes.
If you do, just come up to the microphone and state your name and address and your viewpoint.
Hi, my name is Pat Erica. I live at 47 Latour Avenue, which is just across the street from the
I work a lot, my wife is home alone a lot with the kids. And I don't know Mr. Nathan personally, but we drive by his other property a lot, there was activity going on in there, there was state police in there. And I'm just worried the same kind of stuff is gonna be going on here, and it just makes me really, really uneasy to have two young kids. I'm at work a lot, it just makes me really nervous.
Understand it.
Can we go back to the map that shows the zoning of that street? So it's all service center, but yet there's.
Yeah, so.
So there's still residential within this.
All the residential there is pre-existing non-conforming.
Can I just finish one thing? Anybody else here like to speak to this matter?
We have some stuff to read here.
All right, want to do that now before we get, make some closing public hearing portion?
Yes, we have had several other people with the same concerns that this gentleman just did about some issues that Mr. Nathan does have at his other parcel. He notes that other parcel still, they still have the right, so Mrs. Melinak, she owns, I'll try to show you where she owns the property.
It doesn't go there.
Or doesn't show them?
Doesn't go there, yeah.
So across the road at the end of Victoria Dead End, she owns three.
She's up here.
She owns three separate parcels, and she has, and she wrote a letter along with a couple other people that didn't want to say the name in fear of retaliation. That being said, Mrs. Melinak did write one, she didn't want to say in public, so I'm gonna read it for her. Lisa Melinak, property owner at 54 Latour Avenue, Plattsburgh, New York. Dear Mr. Chairman and members of the board, I have lived and currently own family property on Latour Avenue for over 50 years, the same piece of property. I oppose a proposed variance requested for multifamily housing at 37 Latour Avenue. I believe Mr. Nathan acquired this property knowing of the existing conditions of the property and knowledge of existing zoning regulations. I believe he knowingly acquired this property for a prohibited use and now seeks a variance. I do have to reference the Macon Motel. It is relevant. Driving past the Macon Motel on numerous occasions, I've seen, heard altercations, extreme profanity, arguments, police presence, panhandling, and more. The Macon Motel and 37 Latour Avenue are approximately 100 yards apart. I understand they are separate parcels owned by Mr. Macon, but with the clear lack of management at the Macon Motel, there will be clear lack of management at 37 Latour Avenue, without question. I strongly oppose the granting of this variance at 37 Latour Avenue for multifamily housing. Thank you, Lisa Melinak. That was the one that was submitted.
Right. And you close the public hearing portion of the meeting and you can ask the question.
I'd ask one more question.
Oh. I thought you had one earlier.
No, I just wanted to know the zoning of that area.
When did you buy?
Last year.
Sure.
What's that?
The criteria checklist.
You sure? What?
All right. For a use variance, the check.
I'm just saying, you're.
Right, I'm just saying, you've got to be, I want to be careful as the board member to make sure that we're not, you know, because I've sat here where we have not really been given any financial other than state-oriented financial hardships on property, so I just want to.
And I wasn't here last month, Mr. Mick, we were asked to bring in more information to this hearing?
It was in the minutes that he was asked to go seek some professional help on filling out the application.
But I asked him from the historical place, I contacted with them, and I tried to contact with the dealer who's over me to get that, like, saying that it has been in the market for the last 10, 15, or maybe 20 years. But she don't want to reply my calls. She called once at the zoning office. After that, I tried to contact with her, and she didn't reply me any calls.
There's a historical market, there's a state.
Right.
Right.
They also need to verify what it was, and with any kind of documentation shown.
No, we still don't have that.
Well, he has a letter in here from historical.
Yeah.
There is nothing on their record, but yet there's a market there. And from the last, whatever, a couple months ago, minutes, it's the minutes saying that the recommendation was for him to go to an engineering architect or attorney to show a dollar and cents value as to why it needs to be returned to a four-unit apartment. And to answer their questions regarding the water supply, septic system, and the historical value.
And so how's it suck for you, if that's what you're doing?
Did you say how is this updated?
Yeah.
He bought it, knowing what it was owned for.
He was.
Right.
And well, at the time, it was for a service center.
Right, so it's updated because he bought a building that's in a service center where residential is not allowed, and now he's asking to convert it into a residential use. And nobody did anything or changed anything after he owned this property, created this on top of that. Bought it knowing what, or should have known what it was.
Right, should have known. We don't know what they knew or didn't.
I didn't know that the whole this procedure, I saw that house was for sale. It's about four-unit house, and I checked that condition, and I bought it.
Yeah, I read that somewhere.
What troubles me about this thing is, regardless of the fact that it's a service center district, most of the district is residential. And we're saying that this building, we're kind of holding, we're considering holding it as a service center.
I would disagree with that statement. If you look right behind there, WBTZ is commercial. If you look right down the road, there's a truck repair shop that's right there. At the other side, there's a mobile home, manufactured home, sales, repair. And then you have the gentleman that was trying to come in here that's his, the first one on the road.
Yeah, your office building?
Yeah, it's the office building, which is.
But that wasn't a residential. He was trying to make it residential because he didn't have any infrastructure.
Yeah, so you do, it's when the balance pulling up, I would say there's more commercial than there is residential. Aaron Ovis's old office was.
Right there.
His office was at the beginning of there, so you do have, it's almost an NC, what we consider neighborhood commercial now, where you have both, but it's not zoned, you know, it's a tough, because you have certain businesses that, it's a diesel, I think it's a diesel truck or diesel repair shop.
But we've also argued on other occasions when there's been commercial or residential in a commercial that there's no other use at the end of that street. That street hasn't developed anything into a service center business district in 20 years. I don't know, I'm conflicted because, you know, aside from the commentary, and I get the neighborhood concerns, but I have to put my mindset onto what are we asking one person versus other people on this particular property. If there are other concerns, those concerns would have to be taken to another legal issue, which isn't part of our decision process. The fact that it always has been a residential building long before now. I mean, it's never been anything else there. I just have a concern that we're saying that we've been just arbitrarily hold someone to a different level of scrutiny, when I know in the past we haven't really done it.
Well, we have though, I would disagree that we have to make people say, it's been on the market, I've tried X, Y, and Z, this, you know, it wasn't detailed or in-depth, but they did what this board asked, is they said, just show us what you've done, you put it on the market for 180 days, you tried to market it to, it would be on the applicant to say, I tried to get an insurance place, just went out there, insurance, a tailor shop, anything else, and I have had no luck. But none of that is in front of you, none of that, this board asked 4 meetings ago, 3 meetings ago for that, that hasn't been provided. Just, there's been no, nothing, you had a great dissertation on your professional opinion, but that's gotta come from the applicant.
Mr. DeForest, Mr. Black, you pointed out about this being residential neighborhood, there are 3 existing variances right here for residential.
At the end was, Mrs. Melonak, she did get a variance for a mobile home in that.
Well, I guess I make the argument even on the Levine garage, it's in West Plattsburgh, the fact that, oh, well, it's best in current use was always a garage, even though it was in a residential district, no one ever came to us and said, oh, I tried selling this as a house, I didn't try to convert it into a house, and so we said, well, its best use is what it's always been, and I try to be consistent in the way we're thinking and what we're trying to do as a member of the board. And so I try to take those same criteria and say, I can't just arbitrarily decide when we decide, oh, well, that best use is a garage so we can allow the variance to be a garage. And yet here, it's clearly the only use of that particular building has always been a house, it has never sold. And yet we're gonna say, well, we don't have any proof that it was ever anything else. We never asked the Lox garage.
For that one, they did. They said it was on the market, they tried to sell it, then it was to one people, they didn't rent it. They did come in the next month with all those financials, showing what they did, who they marketed to, and who they tried to sell.
I was part of the request to make that Lox garage use as a garage before the Levines bought it, only because that's what the only intention and the only use of that building was back then. It had no financial back, and there was no discussion about whether it had been marketed or not.
I'm almost guaranteed that the previous owners did. Meyer showed this is what we tried to do, this is what we've had. We have renters that, you know, mucked up the neighborhood, if you will. So we tried to market it for whatever it was, 6 or 8 months. But they didn't come back in that next, what this board asked for, but they provided.
I guess that's my biggest concern too, is that, you know, the board asked to provide some information. You know, I mean, to come back to, you know, readdress this, and we didn't. You know, and the application is, like, lacking a bit, and
why can't you find some of this?
I think it had to do with the financial piece of it. The board asked you for the financial.
Yeah, I called this dealer, she called Mr. Allen too, mm-hmm. She spoke with him, and after that she's disappeared. She asked him what she needs for me.
Three-car garage in the back for the tenants.
So I still call the tenants or the residential units.
So somebody can make a motion to say that it's not, somebody can make a motion to say it's going to be approved, somebody can make a motion to say it's going to run out more information, so yes. What
are you making of those motions?
Secret or secret vote?
Is the application complete in your opinion, Chairman?
No. Well,
question was just asking what other uses in the different properties. So we just need to check a few more boxes and figure it out.
Now, the one that you have, does it have on the page two, does it have scribbled out marks and then new check marks for numbers 10 and 11, or 10 and 12?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so that one.
Just 10 and 11.
We get 10 and 12. No, we scribbled out and S is marked.
Yes. That must be, Mr. Macon, that's your revised secret form?
Is that the revised one then?
It says revised 11/28/17 and the original says 9/26/17.
I did in your office when I was last.
Yeah, okay, so these are your marks where you changed it to.
Yes.
So this will be the revised secret form.
Do you want to do the secret review that, Aaron?
I can do it. Will the proposed action create a material conflict with an adopted land use plan or zoning regulation? No or small impact may occur, or moderate to large impact may occur. I would say no to small.
Agree with that one.
Anybody else?
Terry, you're.
Agree.
Will the proposed action result in a change in the use or intensity of the use of the land? I would say no, since it was being used as residential, and he wants to use it as residential. That would be a change. All agree?
Agree.
Agree.
Proposed action impair the character or quality of the existing community. Again, I'm looking at just the residential use, not who's wants to use it, okay? So residential use was there. There is a residential use still there. I say no to small amount. All agree? The proposed action have a critical environment, there is no impediment. Town of Plattsburgh, so that's automatically a no. Number five, will proposed action result in an adverse change in the existing level of traffic or affect existing infrastructure for mass transit, and biking and walkway? It was a four unit thing. As far as I know, you're going to leave that as a four unit thing. If he decides, he's got actually plenty of land there. If he wants to build another unit, he can come back, but under that would be a site plan review. So I say no to small on that one. All agree?
Agree.
The proposed action caused an increase in the use of energy and it fails to incorporate reasonable available energy, conservation, or renewable energy opportunities. Again, there's no change for four unit.
Mm-hmm.
Probably going to use the exact same electricity that used before. So no to small on that one. The proposed action impact existing public-private water supplies, public and private wastewater treatment utilities. I don't know if it's hooked to sewer or not. Is it a septic system, you know, or is it a sewer system?
I think it is, right? Mm-hmm.
But no matter what it's hooked to,
it's
already there. It's not going to change. So I'd say no small on that one. All agree?
Mm-hmm.
Does the proposed action impair the character or quality of important historic archaeological sites? So this runs into, he's checked with the state. Probably not with the national. So there is a marker out there. Nobody knows who put the marker out there. If that was just the Plattsburgh Historical Society and that was it, or if that apparently wasn't the state. So on that one there, I don't know.
He
put on there as no.
He did, right?
No, what I'm saying is we got the email or the letter from
the
historical society saying there is no historical.
So I would say no to small.
Right.
Do you guys agree?
Yes.
Okay. Proposed action result in an adverse change to natural resources, wetlands, water bodies, groundwater. I would say no, nothing's changing. Mm-hmm. Agree?
I agree with that.
Proposed action result in an increase in the potential for erosion, flooding, or drainage problems. Again, no, it's already developed. Until he decides he wants to build something else on there, that wouldn't apply, so I'd say no. All agree?
Yeah.
Will proposed action create a hazard to environmental resources or human health? Again, looking at the use,
no.
Residential use for four apartments in a residential neighborhood, I would say no. Based on that, all answers are marked no to small may occur. Recommend
to accept a negative seeker?
I do a declaration.
You have a declaration?
Second.
Second.
Show hands on that. And roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Tyler Forrest?
Yes.
Roger Black?
Yes.
Alexander Lewis? Henry Hill?
Yes.
And the next one would be to grant the use variance for the, or deny the use variance for the, and according to our review, which was the two that had it talked about, was the first and the fourth being financial evidence and the self-created hardship.
I mean, I'm reluctant on many fronts, but I guess my heart of hearts is I just gotta be connected with this, and I would make the motion that we accept the variance request, just because I don't see that, I mean, I'm just looking at the parcel when it's used, and I don't see how that is adversely affecting anything in the zoning of that area. So, and based on the seeker and so forth, I would recommend that we would have to approve Mr. Mc, not have to, but I would recommend that we approve Mr. Mc.
Make a motion to approve.
I have.
I'll second it.
Second, and show hands on that. And roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
No.
Tyler Forrest?
Yes.
Roger Black?
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander?
No.
Henry Hill?
Moving towards no.
So, the next appeal is going to be new business. This is where we start new ones. 2112, Mr. Jessica Berdo. Mrs. Berdo is at 1088 Cumberland Head Road. She's asked for an area variance. Request to be allowed to have chickens on her property, which is 25, she's at 25,000 square foot size, and I'm not allowed on a property less than 2 acres to do have chickens.
Hey, Mr. Chairman. This is the Cumberland Head Road here, Brandell Drive here. Her house sits right here. So this is their property right here. This is all zoned R4 district. They are a pre-existing non-conforming lot. This is all R4 district is supposed to be 1 acre lots. Hers is approximately about half an acre. Here's the house, backyard, hedge row here, wooded area over here. I believe the chickens actually stay in a pen over on this side, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So, like most complaints that come to our office, somebody calls and complains about something, whether it's trash, chickens, or whatever. We got a complaint. We followed up on the complaint. She got a letter saying that she was in violation of zoning ordinance. One of her options is either correct the violation or apply for a variance. She's here tonight to apply for a variance. Here's what it looks like today. You can see the wooded lot area here. You can just barely see the pin right back there behind the house, right inside. Okay, ma'am, all yours.
Okay. So, we just have a few notes here. We are stating that we have no idea if chickens were put in on our property. The house in 10 by 10 kennel, the coop is in a 10 by 10 kennel, and we're going up to allow them to escape as males keep having herself. The coop and kennel are kept in the backyard next to the vacant woodlot, fairly visible from the road, as you can see from the photo out there. Because of this coop placement, also, it's located more than 200 feet from the closest neighbor. The chicken's litter is changed and composted weekly, washing the odor coming from the coop, and their feed is kept inside a cooler, inside a shed, as to not attract rodents. The chickens certainly provide us with rich eggs and eggs, and there's rich compost as well as pest control. The chickens will eat thousands of disease-carrying ticks in a day. Many municipalities allow backyard chicken keeping in residential properties. As of 2011, 93% of U.S. cities allow raising backyard chickens. Cities include New York, Denver, Los Angeles, and Burlington, Vermont. A recent research by Forbes magazine will
sudden it's being come up on an appeal after 4 years. I objected then, I still object somewhat today, the smell was bad. Predominantly the wind on the come on head is from the south, and we get it all the time. And like the ad, maybe sometimes people that are grazing these will mow for me, you know, I mean, they just don't notice it anymore, but it is objecting. The other object is, if this gets approved, what's going to stop the other people? There's some pretty nice properties out there, and that's why we bought the house out there. It's quite a nice residential area, and I just object to, you know, making it farmland again.
Thank you. Anybody else like to speak to this matter? I will close the public hearing portion of the meeting and go on to comments from the board members here.
Is there any other way that you could house these chickens to be inside your garage of some sort? If you were to put the coop in there at night or something?
We do have a shed that we place them in, and move them, the pen behind the shed, and that would block the wind from carrying over. What's that?
What about your home, such as the garage?
Oh, where they went in at night?
Yeah, how's that?
That would actually put the pen and the coop closer to his property. Whereas if we put them in the shed, which has a closed door, it's further away from his property, and the pen were behind the shed, it blocked the wind.
Right.
But if you're looking at it, they went inside, they actually.
If they're part of your home, they're more considered a pet than they are agricultural.
I would be opposed to that.
That would be something you could do.
That is the remedy to the situation without needing a variance.
But you don't sell the eggs, or?
No, we're losing part of it.
And then it comes to management, there are ways to mitigate odors. In their current, what is your current setup for them?
Their coop is inside a dog kennel.
Okay, so do they have ventilation?
Yeah.
Do they have a roosting post?
Yep.
Is there a board underneath the post to collect droppings?
They're shaving underneath.
Is there a board that's directly under where they roost at night?
No, we replace one.
This is what will mitigate 90% of the odor.
Okay. Something that can be removed and cleaned away?
Right. You wouldn't use kitty litter, but you'd use something called zeolite. They use it for horse stalls.
Actually, I do have some of that.
Spread it on every day, you have to scrape. You scrape and clean. And do you have small, are they small chickens for them to handle, or are they 8 pounds?
No, they're about 3 pounds, 4 pounds.
Bantams, or are they?
They're regular sized chickens, but they're about this big, full grown.
Okay, so they may be a smaller size. A standard Hamilton guy, and they use a lot more.
You would.
Yes.
That would be something you would do. And you worked out there daily to care, feed them, and water them.
But it's, there are also ideas to mitigate, again, if they were kept in the garage, and you had a separate.
And they could be turned out in the pen during the day.
These are some of the options that the board is speaking, but there's, if you will, ways around our ordinance. People bring pigs into the house, people brought goats into the houses. We have an ordinance that allows that you have to have the 2 acres, so the problems that your neighbor is having, the
continuance now.
And you have to probably say that, but what you're gonna do is you're gonna come out and check, make sure that things are.
Just think about if you wanna bring chicken to your home.
And if it's feasible, how you can do it, and then town would come to look at that and do the situation for the reason.
But if not, and then you would come back and still have this open, you could come back to us and still request it, and then you can decide yes or no, and still maybe no, but it gives you the time to see if you have to.
Yeah, I'm sure there's a check in, suggestions.
Right, for just, it's just, it's a lot of management, if you look up things online, you could probably find a ton of things that you could.
Yeah.
Do, but something like that, that would absorb the odors and clump it together, almost like a kitty litter, would totally mitigate, and you'd be able to keep them.
So, I would like to add, as sympathetic as I am to your situation, I'm troubled by the precedent part of it. And, you know, it's a small parcel of land. I would have a difficult time if you pass this and give it a variance, and then somebody else comes in and denies it. But just keep that in mind.
So, I asked for 2 minutes and didn't check on these other things, and you might be able to withdraw if everything worked out.
Okay, so if I were to move the pen and move them into the garage room at night, would they come out and do an inspection, or where do we go from here?
If they brought the, if they bring the pen in and tie it into the garage, to the chicken coop, and they bring it into their home, so would you go out and take a look at their setup?
Sure.
Yeah.
What did you need for them to go out and check them, because not violation of anything at that point?
They could go out in a pen during the day.
Okay, animals go out wherever you want.
I probably want somebody, if that's the situation, I'd want somebody to go out and just verify that, because there was a complaint about this property, just so we can verify.
Sure.
Yeah, so there's some kind of documentation, so if you do that, just let somebody at the zoning office know. They'd want to take a look. And we, I think if the board's gonna grant continuous, I would recommend 130-day continuous.
130-day continuous, that's what I made the motion on that?
I'll make a motion.
130-day continuous.
Sure, I'll say.
Show in, and roll call vote.
Matt Rogers?
Yes.
Bethel LaFarge?
Yes.
Craig White?
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander, Liz Smolka?
Yes. All right.
Thank you. Thanks.
Next appeal is 2113 Don Roll, 75 Bay Road, just asks for use variance to be allowed to place a shed on a parcel without a primary structure, which is not allowed. Alan, you can go over the details and the pictures that we have.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, this is the Allen Bay Road, or the Bay Road here, off of the Allen Road, comes off, come on Hill Road. The one I'm saying, this parcel right here, the vacant parcel. Again, it's all zoned R4, most of these parcels here, you can see the smaller ones are pre-existing non-conforming. So we're looking at this parcel here. Mrs. Scrow currently lives over here, this is her house, this is her vacant lot over here.
They took just an Amish shed.
Here's what it looks like.
There.
Today?
Yeah.
So this shed looks like it was recently placed.
It arrived yesterday, it was supposed to be next Tuesday, but they did say they can come back and make it if it's not. So, it ended up being a 14-foot by 32-foot garage in there, and as you can see, I'm getting rid yesterday and they called me and I didn't think she was returning, so, and then when they came, they said that they could come back to give them a letter that wasn't approved. Here I am.
Actually, your application, 12 by 28.
Yeah, they upped it on me.
Well, the actual permit application says 12 by 24, then the map in the environmental, it says 12 by 28.
And it went up to 14 by 32, is what I got.
See, this one, it says 12 by 24.
Well, they didn't give it to you, you actually knew that you were getting a 14 by 32.
Right, I got copy.
Man, what size is this yet?
This is a 14 by 32.
No.
Oh, the smaller one is a 12 by 20. There is 15 feet between the back of the smaller shed to where the new shed is in the center there, and there's 27 feet from the side yard to the shed. And this particular lot is 75 by 200 feet.
So is there an issue about subdividing lots with a road if you don't allow?
Yeah, we talked to the assessor, and the assessor said that because of the road, there are two separate parcels already that she couldn't merge them together.
And they're off, if they were
sure.
This, but you can't land hook down the road and over, if that makes sense.
They're just slightly off, yeah.
So we have had, you know, both sides of roads, but not when they're offset, so is it Alan Minor?
No, our assessor, Brian Down.
So, as I said, I'm just trying to get rid of the green tent there, so where the tractor and the lawnmower and that is, the tent right now is about 5 years old and is in very rough shape, it needs to come down and be replaced, so rather than putting up more tents, I just thought doing the shed would be a better option, just for the area, looking cleaner and neater.
Is there a permit or variance currently in place for that existing 12 by 20?
I believe there was, that would be my first concern, that I don't know.
No permit.
Was there? No.
No permit.
That would be odd. That's been in place now, I might say 10 years. And there is 10 feet between the side of that.
Well, you need a permit for anything over 96 square feet.
Did not know that, and as I said, that was years ago that I was not quite happy.
Okay, let's open up public hearing portion of the meeting. Anybody here like to speak to this matter? I haven't seen anybody raise their hands. I'll close the public hearing portion of the meeting. And go to board members if they have questions, comments, and concerns that they would like to address.
Board may want to consider that. This parcel is going to be at least another variance to be in compliance. So they want to...
For the first shed?
Yeah, so this may be another situation of...
The tents and the sheds.
Right, of a continuance to... apply for another variance for the first shed. I don't know if there's setback issues either on the shed that's up there now is like very close to that line. There may be other things that work. I don't want to grant one variance potentially and leave the parcel still out of whack on a couple other things. So it would be better to do this as one package and have it done correctly. It's going to be done at all.
Alan, can you go to the overhead?
So,
this one?
Yeah. Do you have any idea, Mr. Bro, if the first shed is mine?
10 feet.
And it would have to be 50 feet back from the front property line.
And it is. I went out and measured that right there.
That's the property line, not the road.
Would you need from the front?
You got to go from the property line, which is not the road.
Okay.
So you have to make sure you're at the property
yes.
line when you measure, not from the road.
That.
I'm sorry?
Are we sure of that?
The property line?
Yeah.
The Dean Road is like 3 feet off the road. Yes. The pin is.
So.
The pin is actually just about the front of the white truck.
So it's 50 feet to that front building right there?
Yes.
Well, just aside from all that, I guess I'm just having a conflict of the fact that we've denied other people buildings on vacant property before. So I guess we're talking a lot of other things that would normally happen
right.
if there was a house on that property, but there isn't.
Right.
So,
and if I had any way of putting me that on property where I currently live, will accept.
Yeah, we're not understanding.
Should we have a continue, opposed to continues?
I don't know, I might, personally, I don't know that I would approve even the continuance, because I don't think there's anything in the shed light. All we're gonna do is make arguments about whether it meets all the criteria of a normal lot, if there was a house there, and there's still no primary structure on the lot, and we've denied other people the ability to put garages on vacant lots. So I think we'd be contradicting ourselves, or I would contradict myself as a board member to say, yes, you can, but I think 9, 12 months ago, we said no to another gentleman out there in Cumberland.
Right, he wanted to build a structure, put building materials in, so he could build a house.
Well, theoretically,
yeah.
We don't know that either.
Right.
He did it.
Okay, and now, just down the road, there is a garage that has no primary residence on it, to a point where it's laying in the table.
Yeah, that would be up to them to figure out and determine if it's
pre-existing
non-conforming.
I'm just trying to get the tents around from here.
Well, the tents are in violation, they're all in violation, because even a tent needs a permit.
I did not put that.
The tent structure don't.
I was told anything that was built above would need those carports.
Six square feet, if it's the, if you say tent.
Well, whatever, the tarp,
They would not.
And that's because of what?
Because of the canvas tent.
The canvas tents are not, okay.
So, thanks for that, it's more of an eyesore than the only shed that we could look at.
Right, but I guess we're moving that precedent setting, because we've already said no to others, if they couldn't put buildings on, so.
We have granted variances before we would start building garages and lot that, out of a vacant lot, and wind up getting lit by that, because they come back and say that they're not gonna do anything with it. But the request that is out there is to double check everything, make sure that everything would be aligned with that other shed if there. Say, so if you'd ask for the continuation, come up with other evidence at the same time, to make sure that we do have the proper clearances on the other shed that we have there.
Yeah, I didn't know the other shed didn't have variance, that was.
I would think based on the information you guys just gave, you got an incomplete application.
Right. That's why I was just saying, get a continuation, to be able to verify all the dimensions on the property for the shed, sheds that are there.
If it's, complete, it needs a motion to deem the application complete, that would be time, there's no time bomb going, so there is no continuance. So if you need the application to complete, somebody can make a motion and vote on that, and then the applicant can come back when the application's complete, whether it's next month, whether it's whatever.
Motion, that be, that to do, or?
I'm gonna just stand here and say I'm hesitant, because one, you're gonna pay a fee, and if I'm sitting here in the evening and come in, I don't think that I would approve it. So I don't know that anything you're gonna go out and do, anything incur more cost, and that angers a lot of people like that, so I just paid money for this, this got thrown out, now I apply again, and turn around and say no, and people feel like they're just spending money and never really getting anywhere with it. I would want to save you that, because I don't believe, based on our precedent, that I would approve the buildings. The tents, I guess, is allowed, I thought it wasn't, but I don't know that I'd want you to incur more expense to go back and try to get all the answers to things that.
Well, just to get more tents, that's what I wanted.
Well, right, and
that's. I mean, that's just gonna be more of an eyesore to the people, but.
Times.
So, hence I am here.
But that would be up to them to change their ordinances to deal with tents, but at this point, tents are allowed, and all I can say is you can put up tents, but putting up building after building, you know, there's enough of a complaint apparently when they made that ordinance, I don't believe denied it in the past, so I don't know that I'd be consistent by approving one and not another. And I just don't want you to go out and spin your wheels and spend another month thinking you're gonna come back and it's gonna get approved. If I were here, I would vote no because of the precedent that you did. But that's just me. I mean, there's other people here.
That is your call.
With people that have said, I don't come back and pay a fee on the front of the soil.
If you want to do it out there, that's then have to.
Well, Tony, you have to vote first, Tom.
You have to vote, and it's completely.
Yeah.
Well,
just a, it's not just a placement, but it's also, there is no, you can't have accessory structures that are greater than the main building on the lot. Well, there is no building on the lot, so you are, so we have to figure out the.
That's what Mary Ann's point was, is on the application it said one, and on the other application it said another number, and then you just gave another number for the actual size, so the square footage, the size, the location.
Are you comfortable with your neighbors on either side of this lot?
Yeah.
Did you ever thought maybe you'd want to deed over that property as a sale to somebody and retain life lease? Of that use of the property?
We could, except for how we got the property was, my father-in-law purchased it from a neighbor that's currently living there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was one.
You're saying that if it was merged into either parcel, then you've got a primary structure and then you, a lot of this goes away. As long as you maintain a life use of the property, what do you care? There's ways to get around that, because the house is already there and their house would add as the primary structure. There might be some other things that, you might want to check that out. I mean, just from deed purposes, but.
Okay.
Next appeal is going to be 2114 Derek Fleming at 54 Jefferson Road. Asking a request to construct a porch and a deck on the rear of the home that would approach 5 feet to the required point to the amount of front. It would encroach 5 feet into the required 20-foot side yard setback and with only 15 divided and 15 feet on the other side. To the other side with only 15 being provided. Sufficient of a 50-foot sum of the side yards by 20 and only have 30 being provided. So this is also out in Cumberland Head. Alan can kind of go over the details. We're just kind of tucked back into the last lot next to a big parcel.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, this is Cumberland Head Road here. This is the connector road here. This is the subdivision right in here. And there are the very last lot on Jefferson that's being tended to here. So you say, every one of these lots in here are pre-existing non-conforming. These used to be all camps, I believe. These should all be 1 acre lots today, and they're not. Here's the lot here. This is the house. You can see the structure already being built. This is what it looks like as of yesterday. I went out and took a picture. That's the front of the house. So this is the driveway right out in front. And this is the back of the house. So I'm thinking this is going to be the porch, and this is going to be the deck. Then there's, these were provided by the applicant, so this is, they're showing a large view of their lot right here. Here again is the front, this is the back. These are some pictures they took. They're showing a rope here of where the approximate property line is, so they can give you distances across. Hey, sir, ma'am, up to you. Whatever you want to talk about.
Okay, well, my son wanted to have a 12 foot deck on the back and have the deck is no bigger than the house. And I.
No wider.
So originally he just bought the house.
I'm his fiance. This is my future brother-in-law.
And he thought he owned over to the ditch. There's a ditch where you see the high grass. And come find out he's the center of it.
other two sides, the distances between the lot line and the front of, yep.
Oh.
Pre-existing.
Oh, yeah, that was there.
So what you're looking at is 17 feet 7 inches on one side, and the other side is 15 feet?
14 feet 5 inches.
14 feet 5, but this side is what they're gonna be on.
And those numbers are different than the application numbers because,
Right, you got 30 feet on each side.
Yeah, originally you thought you owned the.
No, we found out we don't.
You don't have 83 feet. So the basic item here is.
Getting it for both sides.
Yes. And the whole house, by today's standards, is not conforming, but it's pre-existing conditions. Open up public hearing portion of the meeting, anybody here like to speak to this matter? And that's, anybody raise their hands, we'll close the public hearing portion of the meeting, board members have any comments, questions?
I just need a minute. Calculating, going through, and just giving myself a minute.
How's it, 20 and 30, Steve, Alan?
Yes.
So 5.5 on one side. And 12.5 on the other side.
12.3, then you still got a total, you don't have 50 foot, 2 more sides.
Which the one variance could go away, actually, if they, and they would be able to meet that, if they do go from the line of purchase, so.
Right.
Yeah, we have to merge, so we're gonna put stipulations on the future events that we have not before.
Correct. That's why we would need to do the two variances, one for each side.
I'd make a motion that we approve it simply because it doesn't encroach any further than the existing house, which is pre-existing non-conforming. We're not adding to the real encroachment into these side yards, and I know those lots, because I own one across the road that was a double lot for several years, so I bought that because it wasn't 100 by 100. But I understand a lot of these, and I own the one over on Jefferson that is 50 by 100, and everything's tight, but it's. And well, it doesn't change the neighbor, I mean, the neighborhood is just that way because that's where the lots are, but I don't see how this is making anything worse other than extending more of the property that is in non-compliance because of the lot line, which you're not asking to move within the existing non-conformance of the property. So I would make a motion to approve the variance.
But we have to do a.
You do?
Public hearing also.
You're here? Yes, I did a hot hearing.
I missed it.
Didn't pay attention to me. Whether the benefit can be achieved by other means feasible to the applicant and adding on to the back of the house, that's pretty much what you can do. So to get your screen moving and deck out there. Undesirable change in neighborhood character or to nearby properties. No real change in that. Whether the request is substantial, it might be considered to be substantial just because of the size of the lot, but it's all pre-existing, non-conforming in that area. And whether the request will have adverse physical or environmental effects and whether the alleged difficulty is self-created. We don't see any adverse physical or environmental effects and, you know, it's not necessarily self-created wanting to have that screen porch.
No, it's self-created, we just want to do that with the tour of having, right?
It's different how to use variance than the very different.
Okay.
Use variance if you don't have it self-created, you basically get denied.
So the first one, as far as changing, they actually could by just delaying and buying the property and you wouldn't be able to request it.
For the one side.
For the one side.
Yeah. Anyway, if you could adopt a motion and then if you have a second.
Yeah, I'd make a motion that we approve the variance request on the one side, which is about 5.5 feet. And then the other side being 12.2 feet. Based on the reasons that I stated, the house is already there, it's already non-compliant.